some reason that I'm not having that.
You should want that. You should get the credit. You should default to the credit one. It's just, you know, like John's, for example, somebody from continuing ed, because he's got at least one degree, I know, several, right? He's not doing it to get a degree or a transfer somewhere.
I also, I live in Collin County, so I don't mind paying the added tuition. They're blocking me because my North Texas transcript has disappeared and someone else has my social security number. And I ordered the transcript and when I got it, it's a woman in West Texas. And they won't let me register for credit until because I cannot provide them with a useless transcript from 1976.
But you should be able to sign up for the EAC with no problem, but they're saying that you have to go.
Well, only this one appears in.
Right. Well, we're working on the combo.
The combo is not there yet.
Yeah. Well, let me know, or Dr. Rodriguez is the one to go to if you have any trouble. So I think things are slowly working their way out of the craziness that we have. Yeah. All right, in walk bud. We don't have all our parts here. Let's do it. Let's just have everybody solo. Not at the same time.
Aw, dang.
Alan, you go first? Okay. Going to be Alan, John, Grace, and Joseph. How about that? So 37, all the way through 37. Thank you.
At the end of the coda?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, we've got a G7.
Thank you.
About the F minor, right? 7. We said the Dorian still works really nice, right, for this? Which is basically E flat major. Right, 3 flat. So what's the difference in the G flat major 7? Let's call it a sharp 11 here.
Two more spots, please.
Right. So we got it. G flat. What? So what's
story here?
What mode are we going to use on that second chord for the sharp 11? Lydian, right?
Lydian sharp raised fourth or sharp 11.
So, and that would be G flat's the fourth mode of what key?
G
flat, right? So really, like, look at the two notes that are different. This natural G flat and D flat. So get this scale down. When you get to this scale, all you have to remember is to flat those two notes. Just stay in that same mode, you know, stay in the same flats, just add two more flats and subtract two flats, right? That's a little bit easier way to think of it, you know, especially on piano. If you look at it, you can see it, right? But does that make sense, everybody? Let's do the scale, the solos again, just for a little practice.
Thank you.
You were kind of going to support a little bit. Let me say something of the other real quick. So when you have something like as you get more comfortable with a few scales, right? There's some things inside the scale that you can use, like triads, right? Which is an A flat C, A flat triad inside there, right? There's a B flat triad. All these triad pairs, right?
And they sound pretty neat.
Thank you. momentum to stop when you get the root.
I didn't bring that one. I brought this. This is like the first. The first one. It's called Christmas is Coming. It's kind of a little funky. A
thank you.
Latin group, yeah. So it's 8 minutes on the salary. So there's a couple of cool things about it harmonically. We've got this chord over a bass note, right? Beginning. We know what the technical term for what that is when you have moving chords over the same bass note. Tone, right? It really can create some tension and excitement, right? Notice it's an A half diminished, A concert, right, for B flat, plays into the B half diminished, right, B minor 7 flat 5. I'm on the third line, right? What is that A half diminished? How does it relate to the tonic key? Like, what scale do you use? Like, if you had to give the A a number, does it fit in the key? First off, is A in the key of C flat?
Nay.
So with A half diminished chord. Doesn't really fit, right? It's the sharp four, right? So it's a sharp four walk down. Talk about the 251. Talk about the 3-6-2-5-1. We're extending that down to the sharp 4. 7-3-6-2-5-1, right? Now you got bom 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 bom, right? And they do some tricks with the bass notes to make it go down aspect. But it's basically it's a series of minor to dominant chords, right? It's a little hard to see. I know, but trust me, you'll see this. There's a song called Night and Day. You know that song? Drums for four bars, we come in with the fourth bar, right? Let's give it a shot. 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 4.
Thinking Dora. I was like, what?
They were pulling it from add some other things to it, but fundamentally just the C major scale. Let's do it again. So bring the dynamics down, build it up on the second page, right? So what's the point?
I think we're starting for the solo.
Yeah, I'm sorry, no, we're starting for it again. 1, 2, 3, 4.
Thank you.
the progression, right? So, you know, this is a good example of like taking a bunch of progressions that already exist, you know, and smash them in together, different sections, and it sounds like a new song, but, you know, when you start looking at it, it's like, oh, you know, these are things I've kind of seen before, right? Or heard before. And it's, there's not that much new material under the sun, you know? I know it seems overwhelming as a student, like all these progressions and things, but it does, I wouldn't say come to an end, but there's a finite number, you know, where until it starts to kind of like, oh, this kind of reminds me of that. You know, it might be slightly altered when you look at a new song, but, you know, always look for patterns, right, when you're soloing. There's really not that much of a difference, right? If you learn probably 25 jazz, what we call standards, or kind of the repertoire, there's going to be some repetition. When you look at a new song, it's like, it might be really fast, or, you know, they change the rhythm up or something, but it's going to be, it should be somewhat reminiscent, you know? Well, if you guys have any questions for me, since we have a little bit of time, or we want to play one of the other songs. I've also got,
I have a question.
Yes.
What's a good book that you would recommend for our participants to brush up on it after a year?
There's a lot of them. There's a book that I really like by a guy named Mark Levine called The Jazz Theory Book. Sounds boring, but it's actually a really good book.
Mm-hmm.
And it's got a lot of good advice, like, because he's like, you know, the thing I like about that book the most is like, he gives you some practical stuff in the back. He's like, these are the songs that people play. You go to jam sessions, you know, these are the songs that a good jazz musician should know. And he says something there too that hit me, like, when I read it, like, you know, it's how good you want to be, you know, and it depends on how hard you want to work. It's like, take some work, you know, that's the thing in practice, as we all know. I mean, there's people out there that have a lot of talent that don't maybe practice, and there's people that practice a lot, like twice as much, that maybe didn't work, didn't have this inborn talent. We had this talk a lot earlier, you know, like Jared Combo, with John Kyle Hickman, the Maury territory, but there's some people that, like, I feel like I wasn't a prodigy, you know, few people are, and sometimes that can be a curse unto itself. I'm not saying it's something you'll grow out of. It's like a child actor. And you ever watch, I watched Different Strokes as a kid. I saw a rerun the other day, and I was like, you know, a lot, like, too involved in, like, in jail, all the kids. Jim guy got a lot of trouble. I mean, you know, there's kind of a curse to being like, I'm getting way off track. But, just don't be discouraged if it takes a lot of work. I feel like I used to be in a band room and I heard people playing by ear, walk by piano, and just be like, hey, you know the song? They go, oh, yeah, okay. They play, and I was like, how are they doing that? You know, it drove me crazy. You know, so I kind of set out to kind of figure out how to play by ear, which you can do. It might take a little bit of work, more work than some people, but there's things that you can do, especially now online. Tons of ear training, you know, tons of books. It's almost overwhelming, honestly. It can be information overload. And trying to, like, that's, I think, the problem with today is, like, you have all that stuff. You have YouTube clips, you know, learning how to improvise in 5 minutes. You know, there's finding videos. And there might be a nugget of goodness in there, but the deep learning is kind of lost a little bit, you know. So you guys are here and doing it, so that's great. You know, as opposed to just trying to glean some information here and glean some information here. You know, we go to school to get better quicker. You know, you could probably get a lot of these skills from different places, but you're going to get them faster and have people helping you along the way. So, what he was trying to say was that, you know, it just takes some hard work if you want to play well. It really does. Depends on how much you want to do it. You know, it might be a hobby, you
know, you might want to make this your full-time career, you know, and just, I had a piano teacher, when I was trying to decide what degree to get, he told me, I should get a music education degree, and I want to be a band director, you know. There's nothing wrong with that, but I mean, I like playing music, you know, and he was like, well, if you do that, he's like, I get it, but you're going to have to practice for every day the rest of your life, you know.
Where's the obstacle?
Yeah, being a performance major, you've got to keep it, especially horn players, you know, you've got physical things going on, you know, you guys don't keep your chops up, you know. Being, you know, if you get a music education degree, you can
eat.
Yeah, you're more likely to get a job teaching, you know, which is just nothing wrong with that. But, you know, piano players can get piano pedagogy and have a piano studio student.
Thank you.
Okay, see you later. Have a good Christmas.
Merry Christmas, yeah.
So the jazz piano book's great. I really like that. It's, you know, it's more jazz piano, jazz theory book. He has another book called Jazz Piano Book. As far as just, like, improvising, yeah, there's a really cool book by a guy named Kenny Werner called Effortless Mastery. You might like it. It's not really theoretical, and it doesn't really have to do. It has to do with music. Kenny Werner is a piano player in New York City. Wonderful, all around like improviser. And he talks about kind of like getting over some mental blocks. You know, like practicing something until, like, kind of what you were talking about, like, until, like, I kind of made a comment on you during that thing, but just a general comment of, like, practicing, it's just where, like, you can have it, every distraction in the world, and you can still play it, you know? Like, does that make sense?
Oh, yeah.
I know a guy. Story, but he auditioned for a country band for a guitar player, Clint Strong. You guys know that guy? Mm-hmm. Clint Strong. He went to North Texas when he was 14 years old, and unbelievable bebop and country player. Not sure which country musician it was. One of the outlaw country guys. Well, guy worked with Willie Nelson, but whatever. But he was doing his audition, and he had to play all the music while being distracted. And they would bring people in and do stuff in front of him, and just try in every way to distract him, you know, because he was going to be up on stage with this guy. He was really young, and he passed audition. Merle Haggard, I believe, one of those guys, was like 70s country guys. You ever heard Clint Strong? He sees around Dallas sometimes. Unbelievable guitar player. But just being able just to focus. And the Effortless Mastery kind of has some tips on that. Just to practice until you just can't do it wrong. You know, and that might, for me, that takes a lot of practice. You know, you want to drive your neighbors crazy. You know what I mean? I mean, that's real practice. You walk around the practice rooms. If you hear somebody playing really well, I mean, it's great, but they're probably not, like, practicing. You know what I mean? It's like, there's a difference in going to the practice room and just playing for your pieces. And then we talked about just not, like, you know, really practicing them, right? It's isolated, you know, just like two bars. We just really master them, you know? And then, but the thing is, like, it seems really frustrating. But then that, like, it spreads over the rest of the music. You know, you can just focus on small things, too, you know. It gets a little overwhelming in music school, you know, but there's so much stuff thrown at you. But if you can just kind of focus on just sounding good, you know, just a little bit, and it will grow. Instead of trying to just kind of mediocre, do a bunch of stuff, you know. Which, I mean, sometimes you have to just make a decision. Like, you know, some of my homework is not going to get some of the things that it needs.
Yeah, that's good.
Yeah, I think about that a lot, man. Like, I could be all the time that I spend on everything that I'm doing.
Yeah.
I could spend all that time on just one lesson and one ensemble.
Right.
And I feel like, I don't know.
That's one thing too. Like, it's a time management.
Yeah.
And you're a little older than the